How lovely to be a woman. The wait was well worthwhile. How lovely to
My name is Veronica Vera, and I am the dean of Miss Vera's finishing school for boys who want to be girls. I started the academy really to put more female energy out there because I felt that the world really was in need of more female energy. I felt that part of the reason why the men who came here were coming here was because they just felt so confined in their lives as men. And so I wanted to, you know, help them to explore the feelings that they had that were more associated with the world of women.
Life's lovely when you're a woman like me. How wonderful to know the things a woman knows. How marvelous to wait for a date in simply beautiful clothes. How lovely to be a woman and change from boys to men, to go to a fancy nightclub and stay out after 10. How lovely to be so grown up and free. Life's lovely when you're a woman like me.
My background is really in adult entertainment and human sexuality. I arrived in New York in the early 70s to be a writer. At the time, the only person I knew who was making a living anywhere near the writing field was editing a magazine for Penthouse called Variations. It was about people's first experiences with swinging or oral sex or a whole variety of sexual experiences. I wrote a story for Variations, and they purchased the story. And what that did, it really opened up a field for me that I was very curious about. I really wanted to explore myself as a sexual human being. In writing for Variations, I met other people who were exploring human sexuality from a very idealistic point of view. These were artists and sexual explorers who really felt that the world needed more sexual information, not sexual ignorance. I became friends with other sexual explorers like Annie Sprinkle. I collaborated with Robert Mapplethorpe, Candida Royale, who created femerotic videos, Gloria Leonard, who at the time was a spokesperson for free speech. She also was editing a sex magazine, and Veronica Hart, Jane Hamilton. I had made a few porn movies, but really my field was writing. I had a support system, I had good colleagues, and that really kept me going in this field, which, you know, the field of human sexuality, I really took to it. It really felt like a calling for me. But I felt like a hypocrite because I was not out to my dad. My mom had already died, but I wasn't out to my father about what I was doing. I told him I had been writing, but I never told him what I was writing about. So one day I called my dad and I said, "Dad, you know, I want you to know I'm writing about sex. I'm really good at it, and I know I can help people with it." And he got really quiet, but then he said, "Well, I kind of thought it was something like that." He said, "Because, you know, you've told me you've been published, but you haven't shown me anything." And he said, "But I love you." He said, "But just be careful." He was very relieved because the communication was open then. I don't know what he was thinking I was doing before, but just the fact that we could be honest and talk about it was a big relief for him. So once I was then out to my dad, then I really felt good about my work. And that's why at the Academy, I really encourage people to be out to the ones they love, because being out, being accepting of yourself enough to tell the people who are close to you is very empowering. I think New York is very conducive to people coming here to, and with the feeling of that I can be free here. A lot of people are sent to New York for business or travel to New York and do take the opportunity, especially to be out and about. New York is also a very big walking city. So it's a place where you can be out on the street walking on femme, and that's very thrilling for the people who come here. I've asked students, I said, you know, like, you came from Los Angeles or you came from San Francisco. It's like, you know, why is it New York is so great? And a lot of times it's because they can be out and about walking on the streets. That's a biggie. And in this neighborhood where I launched my school, Chelsea, it's, you know, it's a very live and let live neighborhood. You know, it's not a busy Midtown area. It became, you know, it grew out of the West Village. It was a very gay neighborhood for a while. Now it's more of a mix, but it's always been a very live and let live neighborhood. So, you know, the fact that we're in New York definitely contributed to the growth of the Academy, definitely. When I first began the Academy, the people who called all, you know, from early childhood, they had felt that there was a woman inside of them. You know, they felt this urge to wear women's clothing. But there wasn't really talk about transitioning. Some had very strong ideas that they wanted to live full time, but it was, I considered it my job to help them decide whether this was a reality or a fantasy. Right from the beginning, I identified with the students because I felt these people are trying to get in touch with their sexual selves, just as I had. So I really understood what they were trying to do right from the get-go. And for me, always, sexuality was part of it. A lot of people thought that the people who came here were gay. You know, the first question would always be, oh, is this a bunch of gay people? But, you know, the people who came here, most of them were coming from the heterosexual world. About 60% of them and still are married. About 95% of them are coming from the heterosexual world, and they prefer to live in both worlds. They have a very strong desire to dress, and it's been with them since their childhood. But they want to stay, they have very good reasons to stay and hold on to their lives as men as well. Now, these days, you know, there's a lot of, in the current transgender movement, they like to say this is about gender, it's not about sexuality, but I've always felt that there's a sexual element or a sexual reality that needs to be discussed and part of this. There is the thought, if I tell my partner, then she's going to think I want to transition. And that has come up, that wives will think like, oh, you know, you enjoy cross-dressing. Do you want to be a woman? Either do you want to be a woman or do you want to be with a man? Those are the two fears of the wives. Plus the fear of like, I'm not a lesbian. You know, the wives will have that fear like, oh, you know, have to, you know, get in touch with like, no, I'm not a lesbian. So, and those are real fears. I was surprised, you know, to learn that wives might have that fear, might not know for sure. So I always have felt that it was my job to help the student understand where this is coming from so that when this person wanted to share with a partner, it could be done with understanding and confidence rather than shame. Because, you know, if it's done with shame, then of course the partner is going to be terrified. But if the cross-dresser or the transgender person understands that, you know, this is something that is shared with many, many people, understands a little bit more about where it's coming from, understands that there's a whole world of information and support people out there, and now a whole movement, and many segments of that movement, and there's information available to the partners as well, then, you know, it becomes something where, oh, all right, it's not so scary. I was married to someone who I consider transgender, but he was very happy living in both worlds. So my husband, Stu, was very happy in his male life and also really enjoyed Misty, who was part of his sex life. So I found that when we would share fantasies, Stu was much more open about sharing his fantasies with me than I was with sharing my fantasies with him. So part of my thing is to help couples, both members of a couple, you know, share fantasies and get to know each other in a sexual way to reignite flames. You know, I see people who come here who kind of, they had like a good connection going and then time went on and they've kind of like lost that connection and they have to find it again. So, and part of that has to do with, you know, really being open and honest about fantasies, understanding that fantasies don't all have to become realities. As far as the ages, when I first started the Academy, a lot of people who came here were around the age of 40. And I felt that was because, you know, they say life begins at 40. 40 is the age of self-acceptance. A lot of people would come and say, this is something I've been, that's been a part of me since I was a child. I want to find out more about it. And that's all about 40. And then there would be younger people who would call, like 18 to 20, 18 to early 20s, maybe 26, who were like very curious because this is the age of, you know, college and experimentation and just like trying to figure out who you are. And then now I'm getting more students who are at retirement age from 55 to 65. And that's another big time of transition when when people have more time on their hands, more time to think about like, okay, I don't know how much time I have left, but you know, this is something that it's always been with me and I want to find out more. And when I started the school, the word transgender was really not very much in anybody's vocabulary. It was out there, but really didn't become an umbrella term right off the bat. So now I would say a lot of the people who come here would identify more with a term like cross-gender because they want to live in both worlds. Some might identify with transgender, but still want to live in both worlds. My school is really about self-acceptance, total self-acceptance. Accepting yourself if you want to dress part-time, accepting yourself if you want to, you know, transition, but really self-acceptance and finding people who will accept you as your, quote, as I say now, the authentic, your authentic self. That's why I really encourage the people who come here to just fearlessly go into who they are as sexual human beings and realize that you don't have to feel guilty about who you are, you know, as a sexual human being. And this is, for a lot of people who come here, this is a part of their sexuality. You know, they might not be so active with it, but, you know, it's a sensual part of them. It's a creative part of them. It's play. It's here to nurture them. And then we take what you learn in that mode and then integrate it into your life so that no matter what your fashion statement, you'll be a happier, healthier, sexual human being.